Well, good morning, everybody. Good to see you. Have you ever needed to be rescued? Maybe you were a little kid and you went shopping with your mom or dad and you found yourself wandering off because that toy over here was just awesome and you had to look at it a little bit longer while they moved on. Pretty soon you look around and they're not there. Maybe it was you took off, into the woods up a mountain and you knew you would be the one that would make it to the top in record time. But you got yourself off the trail, you got yourself turned around, and you're not really sure where you were. You needed to be rescued. Maybe you were swimming. You thought you were a swimmer. Doggy paddle wasn't even helping you in this moment, and you needed to be rescued. You think about our lives, there are moments where we need to be rescued. I think back to, I had a surprise 30th birthday party for me at some friend's house. Brenda and Larry were mentors of mine growing up in student ministry, and they were amazing people. And so they had been a part of this plan, and in their backyard was this great pool. So it was a great setting to be able to celebrate my 30th birthday with family and friends. It was shortly after the Mayflower landed, and so there we were. Feels like it was about that long ago, but here we are. And so everybody was having a great time and hanging out and talking. And Heidi and I were living here in New England at this point. This was back in Michigan, so we were catching up with people we hadn't seen in a long time. It was a great time. And one of the families there had little kids, and there was one of them who was feeling really adventurous. He had his water wings on. You ever seen those things, little water bubbles on their arms make them look like he's super muscular, right? So he had his water wings on, and he was eyeing up the pool, and then it came time for him to jump in, and so he was set to go, and he jumps into the pool, and he jumps just like this. Do you know what happens with physics and water wings and water, right? So he went down, and the wings went shoop right off. It was like one sweet motion, and he went right to the bottom of the pool. Now, I didn't even know that that's what was happening until I saw Larry, the host, go running, and he dove into the pool, got the little kid, and raised him up, got him to the side of the pool. Like, it all happened in like 5 seconds. It was like the kid didn't even know. He's like, blink, 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 blink. I'm not even sure what just happened here. And Larry's a stud. Like he didn't even think twice, man. He phone in pocket, he was just there. And he was in there and he rescued that little kid. Think about those moments where everything seems to stop and where am I? I'm lost. I'm not where I should be. And I need somebody to help me. It can be paralyzing. It can be so overwhelming with fear, we just start scrambling and moving around. If you ever got lost in the woods, you just start running and going. You're gonna get somewhere. We end up getting ourselves deeper in trouble. The more that we scramble, the deeper in trouble we get. We need somebody to rescue us. The story that picks up today in our journey through 1 Samuel is a story about rescue. This fledgling nation of Israel, they were just figuring out what it means to be a united people, and they had enemies coming in, and they needed a rescuer. Let's read about that. We're going to look in 1 Samuel chapter 11. 1 Samuel chapter 11. Turn there in your Bibles with me if you would. You can flip it open in your phone, or you can even just do the QR code if that helps you get there quickly. You don't even need to go to a table of contents. That'll bring you right to 1 Samuel chapter 11 so that you can read along with us. And it's important that we all dig into Scripture together. And even doing on your phone like that, you take it with you, and you get to go back and reflect on things for the week if you want. All right, so we're gonna read all 15 verses of this chapter, and then look at this incredible rescue of God. All right, verse 1. Nahash, the Ammonite, remember that, the Ammonite, went up and besieged Jabesh-Gilead. And all the men of Jabesh said to him, "Make a treaty with us. We'll be subject to you." But Nahash, the Ammonite, replied, "I'll make a treaty with you only on one condition, that I gouge out the right eye of every one of you and so bring disgrace on all of Israel." That's quite the negotiation tactic, is it not? The elders of Jabesh said to him, "Give us 7 days so that we can send messengers throughout Israel. If no one comes to rescue us, we'll surrender to you." And when the messengers came to Gibeah of Saul and reported these terms to the people, they all wept aloud. Just then Saul was returning from the fields behind his oxen, and he asked, "What's wrong with everyone? Why are they weeping?" Then they repeated to him what the men of Jabesh had said. And when Saul heard their words, the Spirit of God came powerfully upon him, and he burned with anger. He took a pair of oxen, cut them into pieces, and sent the pieces by messenger throughout Israel, proclaiming, "This is what will be done to the oxen of anyone who does not follow Saul and Samuel." Then the terror of the Lord fell on the people, and they came out together as one. When Saul mustered them at Bezek, the men of Israel numbered 300,000, and those of Judah, 30,000. They told the messengers who had come, "Say to the men of Jabesh Gilead, by the time the sun is hot tomorrow, you will be rescued." And when the messengers went and reported this to the men of Jabesh, they were elated. They said to the Ammonites, "Tomorrow we will surrender to you. You can do with us whatever you like." The next day, Saul separated his men into three divisions. And during the last watch of the night, they broke into the camp of the Ammonites and slaughtered them until the heat of the day. And those who survived were scattered so that no two of them were left together. The people then said to Samuel, remember the prophet, "Who was it that asked, 'Shall Saul reign over us?' Turn these men over to us that we may put them to death." But Saul said, "No one will be put to death today, for this day the Lord has rescued Israel." Then Samuel said to the people, "Come, let us go to Gilgal and renew the kingship." So all the people went to Gilgal and made Saul king in the presence of the Lord. There they sacrificed fellowship offerings before the Lord, and Saul and all the Israelites had a great celebration. What we see in this is this powerful good news that reminds us that when the enemy comes in strong, God completely rescues, and Jesus is king. Amen. Let me just pause and pray for us for a moment. Father, would you, by the power of your Spirit, help this truth to come alive out of your word by the power of your Spirit into our lives? Help us to see what we don't naturally see. Help us to hear what we don't naturally hear. And make our hearts soft and pliable to you today, Lord. We don't want to just hear these things. We want to be changed by our encounter with you through your word and by your Spirit. So do a good work in us, we pray. Amen and amen. Listen again. When the enemy comes in strong, God completely rescues, and Jesus is king. We see this playing out in Israel's life here. We're told right off the bat that the Ammonites were stirring up some trouble. Nahash, who was the leader of the Ammonites. Now, if we were to kind of look at this, we'd see that the territory of the Ammonites, I guess it just turned into blocks. I thought I made it into arrows. That's me. So the Ammon is right there kind of by those two rectangles. That'll teach me to get tricky. So that's Ammon right there. So all this territory over there. And then they had already been kind of hassling Gad and Reuben. These were tribes of Israel. So it had already been kind of making them afraid. And under the filled in square, underneath that is where Jabesh Gilead is. Somewhere in that area. Just wanted to give you a little bit of an orientation to what we're talking about here, right? And so here's this new nation, like from top to bottom. They're just figuring out what it is to be a people. And then they've already got these outside forces that are coming in so strong. And so then Nahash says, "We're going to conquer you. And we're going to," and then the people of Jabesh Gilead is like, "Well, we'll make a treaty with you." He says, "Fine, we'll make a treaty. I'm just going to gouge out all your right eyes. Not both of them, I'm going to leave one for you." You think about that. So this was a humiliation to gouge out the right eye. To gouge out the right eye is a humiliation. Right? You might even remember Jesus. He was teaching about lust. He says anybody who looks on a woman lustfully, he's better for his eye to be gouged out than to have his soul burn in hell, right? And so there's this fullness to this, and it's recognized even generations later. And so this gouging out of the eyes, one, it would be easy to tell who your enemies are. Like if you're meandering down the street and you're not sure, are you Israel or are you Ammonite? Just look them in the eye and you'll know, right? So we got that figured out. It also means like how well can you take aim with your bows and arrows, with your slings, frankly, with anything. If you've only, like we're made to aim with two eyes. It's what gives us perspective. So you're not going to be very effective in fighting, even if you did want to rebel and you've got only one eye. All right? So there are these pieces there that are woven into this. It's a humiliation. The enemy is coming in strong and he's looking to fiercely humiliate Israel. But God had already in motion a rescue that would be taking place. You remember over the past couple of weeks, we've been talking about the anointing of Saul as the new king, as the first king of Israel. And while this wasn't God's plan for them, it's what the people cried out for. And frankly, they cried out for it for this very reason, because they were going to be hassled by these larger, stronger nations. And so God gave them what they wanted, a king. And notice Saul's out working in the fields. He's just got stuff to do. I'm not sure what a king is supposed to do. So he's out working the fields behind his oxen, getting the job done. And then the message comes. And what we see is in verse 6 here is as Saul hears this word of this offense of the Ammonites. Pay attention to how 1 Samuel records this for us. It says, when he heard this, the Spirit of God came on him with force. And as the Spirit of God came on him with force, he was filled with anger. How dare they do this? And then he had quite the display. Like, imagine something happens in our nation. And the president says, bring me two oxen. And he's going to cut them up into pieces and send them to all the corners of the United States. But it got their attention, didn't it? Like, he was just so filled in this moment. He dices up the oxen, sends them out with messengers. Imagine being the messenger. All right. And you're supposed to tell everybody that unless they come to the aid of the nation, right? It's uniting a people. He's saying everybody is for everybody. It's not just for your tribe. This is for us as a people. We stand together. And anybody who does this, this is what's going to happen. Message loud and clear. An hour before, he was out working the oxen. Now he's taking on the crown, if you will, of kingship. And his intention is to rescue his people. He was moved to action. And we see this movement to action is this coming together, God's Spirit and humanity. There's this unity of God and Saul. The Spirit of God came upon him. It wasn't just Saul's doing. It was God and this man coming together and moved to action. And God brings about a thorough defeat. Through the Spirit-empowered leadership of this man, God brings about a thorough defeat of the enemy. We're told that they were killed, slaughtered, and those who survived were scattered, and they were scattered such that no two of them were even near each other. The victory was complete. It was total in this moment. And then we see all the people go, oh, see, this is why we wanted a king. This is what we wanted a king to do for us, to help us be strong and to fight off our enemy. And so then we see this whole thing at the end of this chapter, the confirmation of Saul as king. Now, you may remember at the end of the last portion that we studied together, Saul was made king, and there were a few men who were valiant men, and they went with him. They stood by him. They gave up themselves in service to their new king. And then there was a whole other group of naysayers. Oh, he is our king? You got to be kidding. He's not my king. And with jaws clenched and arms crossed, they refused. So here after this great victory, you know when they've got a great victory, everybody's fired up, man. They're ready to take on the entire world. Bring it on, right? And so they say, hey, while we're at it, why don't we bring those clowns who said no to King Saul? Circle them up here and let's deal with them like Saul dealt with these oxen. Listen to Saul's response. He says, no. No. No Israelite shall die today, for God has rescued us. And then they gather as a nation in worship before God, their rescuer. See, Samuel and Saul want everybody to be clear. God is their rescuer. He has empowered the victory this day through his spirit. But God is the victor. So they worship him. And in doing so, also affirm Saul as king. And so as we look at what's going on here, we understand that the enemy is real, God's rescue is complete, and Saul is confirmed as king. This is what's going on in the life of the nation of Israel. God is establishing himself in their midst, even as he establishes the kingship. Okay? So this is what's going on in the nation of Israel. But remember, whenever we see what's going on here, it's real, it's historic, right? So it's happening, but it's also pointing us to something. God is revealing himself in the midst of this story of the nation of Israel. God is showing the world who he is. That was always his plan, that God would show the world who he is through his people, and that all nations would join him as his people to worship him forever. And God has never given up on that plan. And so while we see what's going on in the history of this new baby nation of God's people, we're also becoming curious. I wonder what this is showing us about God. I wonder what this is showing us about what he's doing. I wonder what this is telegraphing about how he will go about his mission. And in that curiosity, it draws us in. It opens our eyes that we might see more fully. And as we fast forward to our lives here today, we find these same things are true. For to us, a people shaped by God through his spirit, even today, the enemy is real. There is a very real enemy in our midst. Now, we're going to look at some verses as we work through this that are different. We're going to be moving to many of them in the New Testament. And so we're going to move there a little bit fast. These verses will be up on the screen if you want to. I'd encourage you to just go ahead and take a picture of the screen as they pop up so you're not feeling pressure to like flip and all that, all right? So we want to take a look at this so we get a clearer picture of the enemy that is real even today. If we were to turn over to Ephesians, if we were to go to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, it says this, Paul tells us, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Now, he's not talking about there's evil forces invading heaven. That's where kind of the domain that we think of as God's domain, right? But God's domain is actually heaven and earth. That's what Jesus came to do. And so what Paul, when he writes this in Ephesians, is highlighting for us is there is an enemy that is real. There is an enemy that we must contend with. But we don't look at this enemy with our natural eyes. Our enemy is not against flesh and blood. Isn't that sometimes what we do? When we feel threatened, when we feel like there's an enemy, we look at the people. We go, you're my enemy. We go, you're my enemy. Or we might say, this political party, they're the enemy. No, this political party, they're my enemy, right? Our nature is to look at the people in the world who stand opposed to us, who might threaten us, and go, those people are my enemy. And what Paul is telling us and saying, our enemy is not made of flesh and blood. We contend not with flesh and blood, but we stand against the powers and principalities of this world. There are spiritual forces at work in this world, animated division, animated animosity, animating greed and selfishness and wars. There are spirits in our world that give voice to the division that we experience even in our day. And so while we might experience a feeling of being threatened, while we might experience a feeling of anger and pointing at our enemy, as wise and discerning followers of Jesus, we understand that our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the powers and principalities that are at work animating the forces of evil in our world. And we understand it is a battle of a different kind. And while the world may battle as the world is prone to do, as those who are marked by the grace, love, and power of God on whom his spirit rests, we understand that our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the powers and principalities of this dark world. And in the very moment that we hear that, and we might be tempted to go, that seems a little bit Hollywood, Matt. I'm not really sure that it's all that threatening. I'm not sure it's that big of a deal. Let's turn a little bit towards the end of the New Testament in the book of 1 Peter, chapter 5, verse 8. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, he's talking to Christians, your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Just to perk you up a little bit, when your feet hit the floor tomorrow morning, on Monday morning, you step into a world where there is an enemy who is dialing your number. And he is the devil himself, and he prowls like a lion, who is hungry, who is ravenous, and who will rip to shreds anyone he can. Your enemy, the devil, prowls like a lion. He roars, seeking whom he may devour. That's what's real. We hear his roar in the deep-seated anxiety about the world in which we live. We hear his roar in accusation between husband and wife. We hear his roar in the shouting and the conflict between parent and child, between friends, between employers and employees. In the cry of the peasants with pitchforks, we hear his roar. In the political rhetoric of our day, we hear his roar. In the accusations that were made against you decades ago, the devil still roars. That roar may sound like the voice of your mother. That roar may sound like the voice of your coach. That roar may sound like the voice of your teacher that said, you'll never make it. And his ravage is felt in our souls. And all of us must contend with this enemy. In the very same place we're tempted to shout at the people, let us remember that while this enemy, the devil, roars and prowls, our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the powers and principalities of this dark world. The enemy is real. And we can choose, as Christians, We can choose if we will participate with the roaring, ravaging lion of an enemy, or if we will participate with the advance of the kingdom of God, the Prince of Peace, the King of Kings. And even as we stand soberly in this moment, considering our enemy and his reality, let us also remember that God's victory is complete. For he is our rescuer. God's rescue is complete. Jesus is the man, God. Do you see how we saw those pieces come together in the story of Saul, the Spirit of God coming on Saul? It's cluing us in that God's rescue will come in this combination of God and human. And there he is in that, oh, silent night. God's rescue is complete, and it comes through the God-man. Where Jesus is fully God and fully man. In him we see God revealed. Do you want to know what God looks like? Look at Jesus. He reveals who the Father is. Do you want to know what humanity is supposed to be? Created to be? Look at Jesus. He shows you that Eden, humanity, to walk with God and bring in flourishing and fullness. And now because of sin, redemption, restoration, and healing to all people and all creation. The rescuer is fully God, fully man. John reminds us that the Word became flesh. God has shown us who he is. He is a rescuer. How has he rescued us from this prowling lion, the one who seeks to destroy our lives, the one who seems to wants to drag us into his den, the fiery pit, this one who seeks to steal human soul and life and flourishing? How has God overcome him? He has done so through forgiveness. This forgiveness is complete. Look at Psalm 103. Verses 11 and 12, for as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him, who honor him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. If you ever wonder if God's forgiveness is thorough, as far as the east is from the west, he has removed our transgressions from us. And he has done so through the sacrificial blood of Jesus, who gave himself to be ravaged by all humanity's sin. And even in the face of that, in the face of his own death, he said, Father, forgive them. And forgiveness reigns and love settles in through the Christ, the anointed one, the promised one. His forgiveness is complete. Duck back over to the New Testament. We see in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, first stop is verse 17. Feel like I goofed something up here. There is no verse 17. I think I meant 2 Corinthians. Let me look over here a second. Should be a 2 there. My bad. 2 Corinthians verse 17, chapter 5. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. Let that settle in for a second. If anyone is in Christ, new creation has come. The old is gone, the new is here. This isn't just a someday this is happening, this is actually what's happening in real time. For those that give themselves to Christ, the old has gone, the new is here. This is all the language that's woven in throughout Scripture, that God has come to renew all things. And it begins with a people who bow before him in humble repentance and receive his new life through the forgiveness of sin. Those who have been forgiven by Christ are in Christ, and the new thing has begun. The new thing is taking roots. The old is gone, the new is here. God's victory, God's rescue is complete because it's doing a deep work, no longer bound by the old life, but redeemed with a new life that's flourishing and full and good. As we baptize, this is a beautiful picture, going down into the water. The old has gone. The old life, the life of sin, the natural life is done away with, washed clean as far as the east is from the west. And then coming up out of the water in resurrected life, no longer bound by our enemy, but freed, redeemed, restored, and rescued. The old has gone, the new is here. His rescue is complete. And as we continue on in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, picking up in verse 18, all this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us this message of reconciliation. Our reconciliation to God is real. It's true. And it's the foundation of this new life that we have in him. Not because we have earned it, not because we have worked hard for it, but because we have received this gift of grace by faith and are reconciled to God. When steeped in our sin, we are alienated from God. We are enemies of God. And the only way to make it right is through Jesus Christ himself. And his spilled blood on our behalf reconciles us to God. His love reconciles us to God. His forgiveness of sin reconciles us to God. And he claims us as his own. And this is how he makes a new people that bear his name, that walk with him, and that live in such a world that all creation knows that Jesus is Lord. This is the work that God is doing in our midst. And all of this confirms Jesus as king. See, Jesus spilled his blood to the point of death for the forgiveness of sin. But he didn't stay captured by death, entangled by death. For on the third day, the stone that covered the entrance to the tomb was rolled away. And he walked out. See, Jesus became king through his death and his resurrection. And he was confirmed as king by his resurrection as Lord of all, King of kings. Turn with me, if you will, to Philippians. Philippians chapter 2, verses just 9 and 11. Right? Jesus humbled himself to death on a cross. Verse 9, therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The enemy is real. God's rescue is complete in the God-man Jesus Christ. And this same one who humbled himself to the point of death, a cruel death, a humiliating death on the cross, this same one is exalted to the highest place. The highest place among heaven and earth, that every knee will bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. There is no higher authority in all the world. Jesus is the king. And this king has come to rescue you. This king has come to rescue you, that you might know life now and forever. And so the question for you becomes, the question for me becomes, if this is true, what claim does this make on my life? If the enemy is real, how does that influence how I view the world around me, how I understand what's going on in our day? If God's rescue is complete through the God-man Jesus Christ, how does that influence the way that I live? How does that influence my source of peace and how I reflect on the brokenness of this world, let alone my own? And if Jesus is king, what are the claims that he is making on my life? Let's pray. Jesus, we bow before you in humility today. We proclaim that you are king. You are Lord. Thank you for rescuing us when we could not rescue ourselves. Fill us with your Spirit that we might walk with you now and forever. And that everywhere we go, every piece of ground where our feet step, we would see the kingdom come. We would see your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. But this only happens as you give us what we need for today. And so we ask you for that, Lord, that you would fill us with the bread of life, that we might know freedom, joy, peace, and love. And teach us to walk with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Stand with me if you would. A couple things. One of them, maybe there's something stirring in you. You're here today and you have never made that decision to follow Jesus. You hear and see what's going on here with the baptisms. You hear this proclamation of the Lordship of Jesus and his incredible rescue for each of us who are ensnared by the one who seeks only to shred us to pieces. And you're hungry for that kind of life, that kind of new life. You can do that today. I want to invite you to come up and talk with our prayer team. Tell them you want to follow Jesus. And they'll walk with you in that you might know life now and forever. Don't leave here without settling that today. And maybe there's something that was stirring in you during this. And you're like, I've done that, but I need to settle it. I need to get baptized today. Hang around, talk with Joe or I. We'll talk with you about baptism. We got an extra towel and a t-shirt. We'd love to baptize you even at the next service, right? We can get it done. So if you want to do that, let us know. And then kind of more of a housekeeping thing before you go. Just a reminder, this week we're going to be getting kind of carpeting redone in here, roofing over here. So the building's going to be largely shut down this week if you show up, just like with some cookies or flowers or something. We probably won't be here. And so don't do that. Bring it next week. But if some of you can help us after the next service, we need to clear this room of all the chairs. We need to clear conference rooms and family room of all the stuff there. And so Mike is the boss. And so if you can stick around or come back after the 10:45, we'll take care of that business together. All right? Thanks, everybody. May you walk in his peace. May you walk in his joy. May you walk in his life, knowing that you are rescued by a very good God. Walk with him as you go.